Rachel, 54321. Rachel, they're started. Did you want to say something? They've started. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sunday. Yay, I love it. If everyone could please take your seat, we are going to now enjoy our prelude. Thank you.
Brother works in a factory, making cars for a salary. They've got a pool, kids and a dog, a pleasant life in suburbia. We'll close a factory down, what would they do? What would we do? Well, cities are built around industry, wages support families. We'll close the factories down. What would they do? What would I do? I'm thinking while I'm driving around in my brand new car, wearing brand new clothes and drinking drive-through coffee. Oh, take them away. What would we do? What would you do? We got factory farms making factory food, and we're being fed factory news. Nobody's buying handmade no more. We're all shopping in big box stores. We'll close the factories down. What would they do? What would you do? I'm thinking while I'm driving around in my brand new car, wearing brand new clothes and drinking drive-through coffee. Oh, take them away. What would we do? What would you do? Children will be left to save the world from what we leave them behind. And if humanity is on the brink of destruction, what would they do? What could we do? What can we do? What can we do? What can we do right now? Well, I'm driving around in my brand new car, wearing brand new clothes and drinking drive-through coffee.
Good morning. My name is Mary Ellen Scanlon, and I'm your worship leader today. My pronouns are she, her, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the First Unitarian Church of Hamilton. We welcome you here in the sanctuary, and also a welcome to those who are joining us online. As I said, I'm this morning's service leader, and I want to thank the other members of today's service team, which includes our music ministers, Rachel Derry, and you've already heard from Marianne Forbes. Jennifer Reed is part of the music team today because she wrote some of the lyrics that you will be hearing during the service. The tech team this morning is Brian Carey, John Elliott, and Chase Tapley. Our ushers are Daphne Payne and Agnes Cunningham. The worship assistants are Susan Johnson and Ian Johnson. And we also today have CYRE folks at the back here, Audrey Johnman and Tanya Collins, and they will help anyone who's interested in making wrapping paper and decorating gift bags as a alternative to buying Christmas wrap. Oh, I should also mention, one of the things I was supposed to remember is we will be using shakers, musical instruments, during the latter part of the service. Some of you have them already, good. And Daphne has the basket there for anyone else, but you won't need them till later on. And I know you promised not to use them until then. So our announcements today, we have a few, but we're going to begin with an announcement from Mel Rutherford from the search team.
Thank you. I have an exciting update from your ministerial search committee. Our congregational record and our candidate packet are live on the internet. The congregational record has information that we learned from you, from the surveys, the cottage meetings, and the focus groups. We've already gotten positive feedback on those materials. We've heard that ministers have already started asking questions about us. Those materials will be live during the month of December. Ministerial candidates will be looking at those materials and thinking about us. On January 2nd, we, the search committee, will get a list of ministers who have indicated they're interested in our congregation, and we'll get access to their portfolio online. From January through March, we'll be learning about those people and meeting those people. As soon as we have a candidate, we'll tell you who our candidate is. We anticipate that that candidate will come the week of April 21st to 28th here to Hamilton to meet all of you. So we've got some exciting times ahead. The results from the survey, we printed out some hard copies that are available in the lobby. During this whole process, a lot of what we're doing will be confidential, but feel free to ask questions of anyone on the Ministerial Search Committee if you wish. That's Beverly Horton, Gail Rappold, Karen Trollope Kumar, Jennifer Reed, Angela Morgan, Mary Ellen Scanlon, and me. You can ask any of us questions as we go along. Thank you.
Thank you, Mel. The other announcements today, the first is was sent to us by Martin Dooley, and it's a note from Sam Campanella, who's the executive director at the Eva Rothwell Center. And Sam writes, "To all of the angels at First Unitarian Church of Hamilton, thank you so much for sharing your love and support for the children and families at the Eva Rothwell Center. Your contribution of $1,700 in gift cards, clothing, toys, and a financial donation of $480 will be put towards our emergency food pantry. This holiday Christmas season will be a special one for all of the families to remember, because you were all willing to impact and continue to break the cycle of poverty. The Eva Rothwell Center is truly blessed to have this wonderful partnership that will forever make a difference. Thank you, and I wish everyone a safe and happy holiday season. Sam Campanella." Pat yourself. All members of the Two-Spirit LGBTQ plus community are welcome to join us today for the monthly Queer Joy Potluck in Room 9. Please join us, even if you didn't bring anything this morning. The potluck happens on the third Sunday of every month. The second annual family Christmas dinner for 2S LGBTQ plus folks and friends. This will be held on Christmas Day, so you don't have to spend Christmas alone. Join us in the church lobby Christmas Day, 2 to 6 p.m. for a turkey dinner. Bring any food that you would like to eat and share. There will be games and carols. If you would like to volunteer to help, contact Sylvia LaFontaine. And the link is also in the All Church email. And for everyone, please make sure to come out to the All Ages New Year's celebration at the church from 5 to 9 p.m. That would be New Year's Eve. Pizza and snacks will be provided as we join together in fellowship. There will be board games, a puzzle table, a station to create care bags for the unhoused in Hamilton, and much more. and a reminder that this is a dry, family-friendly event. For more information about these events and to register for those that require registration, please see our website and the weekly All Church email.
As lighting this chalice calls us to be together, let there be light. As the chalice reminds us of our values and eight principles, let there be light. As the glow of the chalice encourages us to be hopeful, let there be light. Let there be light. Please join me in reciting our unison chalice lighting words. May this flame be our light of friendship and love. And now we have a reading for the lighting of the Advent candles. The placing of candles upon a circle of evergreens is an age-old tradition. Lighting additional candles each day or week as the light wanes has been a part of human rituals for centuries upon centuries. For us, here in this time, the circle of evergreens reminds us that life and love will never end. We light candles each week with anticipation, as we know a new season will soon be here. Days will become longer, and we know the warmth of the candles will soon be replaced by the warmth of the sun. The third candle we light in this Advent season is one of joy. Where do we find joy? It is in the simple things, like a warm and fragrant cup of tea. Or is it in something monumental, like the birth of a new family member? In this, the season of sharing, may we find joy in the mundane, the monumental, the familiar, and the strange. Joy can sometimes be elusive, and so we light this candle to help guide our way. We light the candle of joy.
I realized as Sheila started to speak that I didn't introduce the service leading team today, other than myself, Sheila Van Loosden, and Linda Sivier, and we're all members of the Climate Action Team. And our speaker today is Jennifer Reed, who I'm sure most of you know as a congregant, and she's going to share her family's experience trying to make a difference in the world, particularly during the fall. So we will hear from Jennifer later. This morning, I acknowledge that Hamilton is situated upon the traditional territories of the Erie, Neutral, Huron-Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and Mississaugas. Today, Hamilton is home to many Indigenous peoples from across Turtle Island and elsewhere. The land here is covered by covenants and treaties. We are, all of us, treaty people, the original inhabitants and those who came later. We are inheritors of a diverse history, dwellers in a common land, and travelers toward a better day. We respect our treaty relationships and responsibilities to both the land and the original people who reside here. Those responsibilities include using two-eyed seeing as we confront the climate and environmental crises around us. And whoever you are, whomever you love, wherever you are on your journey of faith or search for meaning, today you are one of us and you are welcome here. in this house of worship. Our mission is to nurture one another, serve the community, and inspire action to heal the world. Climate activist Zipporah Berman has described 2023 as the year Canada exploded. The intense fires of the summer have been predicted for decades by climate scientists. Over 150,000 people across the country were under evacuation orders this year. Tens of thousands were forced out of their homes and communities, and some came back to ruins. Extreme weather events, drought, and heat also impacted many during this hottest year on record. It is no wonder that 3 out of 4 Canadians worry about the climate crisis, and a third believe that it is too late to do anything. Younger people are especially anxious about the future. Angry about the world my generation is leaving behind and the failure of our leaders to deal with the crisis appropriately. It is our hope that today's service will reassure you that you are not alone with your concerns about the climate and the future. We also aim to shine some light in the darkness. The words of Carol Altman Morton. Many of us carry a burden of worry, anxiety over the state of the world, worries about money, about our environment, our families, about peace and justice. May we trust that nothing will get worse for us putting that burden down for a moment. May we let go of that that weighs us down. In our experience of letting go, may we be open to the possibility that we need not pick our worries back up. May we find passion and strength to work for change where we have the power to do so, and to let go where we do not. If not forever, let's put down any worries or anxieties for the next while. May we be in worship together. Our opening hymn is an Advent song. It's kind of a gentle one that I've always liked. Hymn number 224 in your gray hymnal, Let Christmas Come.
You may stand if you are willing and able, and join with me.
Good morning. Our story for all ages is a favorite one, A Coyote Solstice Tale by Thomas King, with pictures by Gary Clement. The world was a wintry wonder. The snow piled in mounds on the ground, while Coyote was anxiously waiting for all of his friends to come round. "There's nothing like a feast," said Coyote. Then out in the heart of the forest, where the trees block the light of the moon, came the cadence of somebody prancing and humming a holiday tune. "It's Beaver and Bear," cried Coyote, and he rushed to the door, arms outspread. But there, on the porch, in the moonlight, was a little girl, all dressed in red. "Hello," said the girl. "I'm a reindeer." And she pawed at the snow with her toes. She had sticks in her hair and a green teddy bear and a red rubber ball on her nose. "Good grief," said Coyote, quite shaken. For he knew, as everyone knows, that people and creatures stopped talking a couple of eons ago. "Hmm," said Coyote, "this could be awkward." "But there's ever the matter of manners and tradition, it's always been said. Insist that all guests be made welcome. Insist that all guests be well fed." "You've arrived just in time," chirped Coyote, "for our feast is about to begin. You're not at all late. Let me get you a plate." "Are you sure it's the right house you're in?" "I've come to the woods," yawned the reindeer, "to find friendship and goodwill and peace." And she curled up in front of the fire and she wrapped herself up in a fleece. Then out on the star-brightened meadow, the ice crystals tickling their feet, came Beaver and Bear and Otter and Moose, their bags filled with groceries and treats. "Get in here," said Coyote. "You have to see this." "She's probably lost," offered Beaver. "It happens this time of the year. Let's follow her footprints back through the snow to see how she got way out here." So the animals put on their woolies, and Moose set the girl on his back, and they tromped through the dark, frosty evening till they came to the end of her track. "Hey," said Coyote, "what happened to all the trees?" And there, at the edge of the clear cut, set alone against the western skies, was an object so bright that it lit up the night and made everyone cover their eyes. All the animals stood round squinting at the sight, full of wonder and fear. "It has to be new," stuttered Otter, "for it wasn't here this time last year." The little girl straightened her antlers and she jumped down onto the snow. "Oh, that's just the mall," she said, fixing her nose. "It's no place that you want to go." "A mall," said the animals. "What's a mall?" So down the steep slope they tobogganed, sliding right through the packed parking lot, then in through the doors onto full marble floors where the lights were dynamic and hot. The noise was completely unnerving, the music a pain to the ear. All the people were bumping and pushing, attempting to find a cashier. The animals huddled together as rough herds of humans rushed by, their arms filled with brightly wrapped boxes and murderous looks in their eyes. "So this is what humans do," said Coyote. And before anybody could stop him, Coyote was out on the floor loading every new thing in his basket as he scampered and skipped through the store. "Here's a plasma screen TV for Otter and a digital watch for Bear, 4 volumes of Proust for my good friend the Moose, and for Beaver, a vibrating chair." So up to the checkout, he swaggered. Who knew shopping could be such a thrill? Then the saleswoman tallied his presents and cheerfully passed him the bill. "You've made some exceptional choices," she said, "and excess is truly the key. Will you purchase these items with credit or cash, or buy them on time, interest-free?" purchase? Said Coyote. The stars overhead were resplendent when Coyote slouched out of the mall. I'm sorry you all had to see that, said the girl with the red rubber ball. That's why I pretend I'm a reindeer and put these two sticks in my hair. I'd much rather live in a generous world where everyone knows how to share. But my parents are probably worried, so I ought to return straightaways. But perhaps I could visit next season and stay for a couple of days. Sure, said Coyote. Reindeer are always welcome at my place. The world was a wintry wonder, with the rumors of light in the east as the animals strolled to Coyote's to continue their seasonal feast. All this walking has made me quite hungry. All that shopping has left me quite numb. I may have to rest, said Coyote, and wait for refreshments to come. So Otter and Moose made corn chowder, and Beaver and Bear baked the bread, while Coyote lay there in his comfortable chair with a pillow tucked under his head. And after the eating and drinking, after all of the stories were told, after most of the mess had been tidied, everybody went out in the cold to sing as the light filled the heavens, to welcome a splendid new day, and offer a prayer for clean air, for clean water and air. Then they parted and went their own way. And Coyote, well, he sat on the porch in his rocker, and he rocked as he tried to recall if goodwill and peace could be purchased for credit or cash at the mall. Probably, thought Coyote as he smiled and closed his eyes. That place had everything.
Now, the children will be staying with us today, and so a reminder that the activity card is available and the tables at the back for doing crafts. Oh, I see they've got one person joining them. So. It's time for our meditation. In these moments of contemplation, I invite you to relax, close your eyes if you like, and breathe deeply. Following the reading, there will be a few moments of silence, followed by music. And during the music, you are welcome to come up and light a candle of joy or concern. This morning's reading is adapted from one by Erica Barron. Today, we will take the time to acknowledge all those already lost or harmed as the world feels the increasing effects of climate change. As we acknowledge these losses, we will respond, "We remember you." To all those people lost to extreme heat waves, we remember you. To all those harmed by hurricanes, tornadoes, cyclones, storm surges, floods, and mudslides made worse by climate change, including today the people in North Queensland, Australia, we remember you. To all people suffering hunger and displacement due to drought and changing crop patterns, we remember you. To all those, including many Canadians, who have been lost or harmed by intense wildfires due to extreme fire weather and other climate-related causes, we remember you. To all our relations in the interconnected web of existence, the animals, trees, and plants who are harmed by the impacts of the climate crisis on their habitats and populations, we remember you. To all those who experience anxiety about the climate crisis and fear for their future, we remember you. We remember you, and we commit ourselves to restoring balance. So may it be.
Christmas, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again, because a vision softly creeping left its seed while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains. Within the sound of silence, in restless dreams I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone, neath the halo of a street lamp. I lift my collar to the cold and damp, when my eyes were stabbed by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence.
It seems there are no written joys or sorrows today, but we know that there are sorrows among us too tender to share, especially at this time of year. We hold those in this space today with the reminder that we are never alone. And there are joys among us too, particularly as we've lit the candle for joy, and we celebrate the joys among us and rejoice in the happiness that flows through this community. Our offering is a reminder of the spirit of generosity that is at the heart of this religious community. There is no church without its people. We are the church. We are all it means inside these walls and all it stands for out in the world. We receive these gifts gratefully and we dedicate them to the work of our congregation, welcoming the stranger and upholding religious freedom, honoring human wholeness, and caring for our planet. Together we seek to serve with ever greater love. We will now receive the offering while listening to the music ministers.
It's me again.
Marianne sang about a world without money, which is a great vision, but for now, your gifts in support of our ministries to one another and to the community are appreciated. Thank you. Jennifer?
Hello. I'm going to start today with a little bit of my history. I grew up in the First Unitarian Church of Hamilton, which, when I was a child, was located at 268 Aberdeen Avenue. I actually have a picture of that church right here, so I'm just going to show it to you so you know what it looks like. So here it is. It was a house on Aberdeen Avenue. I'm just going to put it up here so everybody can look at it. Unitarian values contributed to my left-leaning activist worldview. Some of my closest friends today are those I made as a teenager, attending youth conferences and working at Unicamp, the UU summer camp located near Shelburne. When the oldest of my three boys was a baby, I started to attend church more regularly and served for several years on the CYRE, including a few years as chair. Professionally, I am a classroom teacher, and climate issues are always something I include in my lesson plans. Outside of the classroom, I was involved with EcoSchools, a school-based environmental action program, which was a great experience, but only impacted the specific school I was teaching at. So I wanted to bring the issue of climate change to my union, the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario. I went to annual meetings where I brought forward climate change resolutions, several that passed, and started a climate justice and sustainability committee in my local. But through my union and my classroom, I had been doing a fair bit of climate work. But just on March 20th of this year, I heard Antonio Guterres, the Secretary General of the United Nations, state, "The human time bomb is ticking. Humanity is on thin ice, and that ice is melting." A few days later, he also said, "Every year of insufficient action to keep global warming below 1.5 degrees Celsius drives us closer to the brink, increasing systemic risks and reducing our resilience against climate catastrophe." Hearing those statements close together resonated with me, and I had an epiphany. I needed to focus more of my emotional, intellectual, and activist energy on the climate crisis. I started to read more and increase my knowledge and understanding, and I also started some seedlings for my garden. 10 days later, on the Monday after the Easter weekend of 2023, my family from Stratford had been at my place for dinner. My dad left behind his copy of the Toronto Star, which I read. In the lifestyle section, there was an article about the winner of the Live Net Zero contest from Canadian Geographic. I took a look at the contest online and learned that it was a competition in which five families from across Canada competed to reduce their own personal and household emissions, with the winner receiving a prize of $50,000. I decided to apply. Contest submissions consisted of a short video, and in June, we found out that we were accepted. This time, the contest had eight families competing. The Live Net Zero contest consists of six challenges, five two-week challenges that started in early September and ended about a week ago, and a one-week break between each, and a longer home improvement challenge, which lasts 8 months. The contest is judged in two ways. 40% is quantitative, measuring specifically how much each household reduced their emissions. 60% is qualitative, looking at storytelling, creativity, and our level of effort. So, like the judging, I'm going to share with you some of the quantitative aspects of the contest. How my family, my partner Steve, and my three boys, John, Cameron, and Owen, significantly reduced our emissions, and I will provide with you some additional resources through a website we have developed to share information. However, I'm also going to share some of my reflections of the climate crisis, the quantitative journey, so to speak, and how my climate activism has become a spiritual journey in social justice, and a journey that has roots in this congregation. So the first two-week challenge started on the first day of school and focused on commuting. How do we reduce our driving? I approached this in a number of ways. When getting to school in Burlington, I traveled by electric scooter to my friend and colleague Denise's house, and then I drove into work with her. As I zipped through the streets of Dundas, I listened to music and felt joyous and an almost organic connection to my community not experienced in a car. Furthermore, Denise and I, while quite good friends already, deepened our friendship. We chatted in the car for an hour each day and continued to carpool after the challenge was over. Our new, deeper friendship is very meaningful to me. If you could show the scooter video, that would be great.
All right, Jen's on her way home from work using our e-scooter. We're going to avoid using the car for as long as the weather safely permits. She's commuting with a colleague so that we don't have to drive at all, hopefully for quite some time.
I took the city bus into work one day and regularly took it to church as well. The trip into school was long, an hour and a half, and is a trip that many people take every day. Taking the bus helped me recognize my privilege as a middle-class white woman and the many easy things that I have in my life. To reduce driving to the store, as I harvested the vegetables I produced in my garden, and you can't really get much more local than that. I know that there are many avid gardeners in this congregation, but if anyone here has not discovered the joys of planting your produce or plants, I encourage you to jump in. Many mornings in the summer, the first thing I would do would take a look and see how much the zucchinis had grown. Talk about spirituality, light energy, nutrients from the soil, seeds, plants, food we can eat. Observing that process connected me with the earth in a way that is hard to describe in words. Side note, I do hope to take what I learned about vegetable gardening and build a community of gardeners at my school where a large number of families struggle with food insecurity. My family also visited the Plug and Drive, which it was just a super fun and interesting trip, and it shared and taught us information about electric vehicles. I was ridiculously enthusiastic, and my sons less so. And while this was the case, we did play it up a bit for our story. If you could put on the Plug and Drive video.
Nope.
Plug and Drive. We're inside the Plug and Drive. We're getting ready to test drive an electric vehicle. After the commuting challenge ended, we had a week off and then started our next challenge, the home envelope, which began at the end of September. I didn't know this. The home envelope is all the parts of the house that separate you from the outside. Windows, doors, walls, roof, floor. Now, some interesting facts about this. Half of the heat in an average home is lost to the outside in an hour through the cracks in the home. If you add up all the leaks in an average home, it equals between 1 square foot and 4 square feet, which is like having a window open all winter long. We went through the process of finding and sealing as many of these little leaks as we could by caulking, weather stripping, and putting foam inserts into exterior electrical outlets. We also realized that our crawl space was not insulated, which, maybe that's why our bedrooms were so drafty, and arranged to have some of our older windows replaced. And now if you could put up the cartoon, I'm going to share a little cartoon by Rosanne Pravec. I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce her name, but she is a Dundas artist and cartoonist who drew this for us, actually, which was really great. And I don't know if you can see it online or not, but it's two beavers inside their beaver dam. And it says, turns out the home envelope is like all other envelopes, addressed, airtight, and risky to lick. Throughout the fall and the busyness of life, renovating our home, creating blog posts, I was thinking about our individual efforts. I could feel that our home was becoming more comfortable and that we would also be saving money, which is really exciting. And I felt proud of the work, the fun we were having as a family, and what I was learning. But I also realized that if it was just us doing this, then the entire exercise was pointless. I was also reading, one sec. This excellent book by Naomi Klein about how she had been confused during the pandemic with lefty feminist Naomi Wolf, who wrote The Beauty Myth years ago, and who during the pandemic became an extreme anti-vaxxer and aligned with Stephen Bannon. The book delves into the topsy-turvy politics we have seen over the last few years and some of the strange and disturbing shifts going on in the world. I realized that I needed to not only be a local climate activist, I needed to not only develop a local climate activist community, but in general, just more community. As bell hooks writes, community is where love and resistance meet. In our absurd world, I needed a place with more love and more resistance. I reached out to the people I knew in my neighborhood, people like Jean Jacobs, who attends the church and lives down the street from me, and I dropped off little leaflets in the mailboxes of folks who had Save the Greenbelt signs or had a pollinator garden. And then a group of about 10 people in the Highland Park neighborhood got together and we formed the Highland Climate Action Group. And if you could put on the Highland.
So I think this has been a pretty productive meeting of our community group, actually talking about climate change ideas. I really liked what you said before about the water barrels too.
Yeah, well, I think this idea of coming together and having a community event, I think that's gonna really get things kicked off.
I agree, yeah, I'm really excited that we're organizing a walking tour and we're gonna highlight our new heat pumps and our heat pump water heater, so that's very exciting.
I think people will be really interested in the forest and seeing what that's like in our neighborhood. And of course we have expertise with building and...
Yeah, I think there's gonna be a lot of different topics that people might be interested in.
That video is a little bit staged, but does reflect what we were doing. And we did host a walking tour at the end of November, and we had about 25 people from across Dundas come and join us. And we went around and looked at different homes and different pollinator gardens, and there's a mini forest down the street from us as well. Outside of supporting each other in sharing information and reducing our emissions and sharing our collective knowledge, it was an opportunity to get to know my neighbors much better. I now have a much stronger local community. And here is one of my biggest learnings from this journey: banding together with a group of people to acknowledge our worry and then empowering ourselves to take action is the most powerful way to address the climate crisis. This felt like a great starting point, and it has encouraged us to plan and organize more events. On October 16th, the heating and cooling challenge began. We decided to invest in a new heat pump, air handler, and heat pump hot water heater, and subsequently capped our gas line. We do not rely on fossil fuels anymore. So here's a big question: how do we pay for it all? There are three programs that can be accessed. In Ontario, if you are an Enbridge customer, you are eligible for up to $10,000 in rebates. This program is called the Home Efficiency Rebate Program, or HERPLUS, which is ironically in Ontario administered by our gas company. You need to arrange for an energy audit and complete home upgrade recommendations provided to you in the report, and then you have a year in which to do this. You then arrange for another energy audit and receive the rebates. There is also the Canada Greener Homes Loan, which is up to a $40,000 interest-free loan to be paid off over 10 years. On December 1st as well, the City of Hamilton launched the Better Homes Hamilton program, piloting a residential energy efficiency retrofit program in which interest-free loans are available, but credit scores are not as important and the loan is paid back through your property taxes. Through the subsequent two challenges, electricity and the holidays, the lessons I learned were similar. Electricity focused on reducing our electrical power consumption, and we became more intentional than we were about hanging our clothes to dry and turning lights off. We also started using power buys to stop wasting phantom power, which refers to the energy that's wasted around your home when devices are plugged in and use power, but you're not actively using them. The Holiday Challenge, which wrapped up last week, looked at all the ways we can reduce our emissions during the holidays, and which also, of course, applies to daily life as well. Instead of new gifts, I have made gifts, re-gifted, and am requesting experiences instead of a physical gift. I have planned a vegetarian meal for the holidays and wrapped presents in old chart paper from school. For me, these were both similar in that I am paying attention very closely to the waste our society creates, and am removing that waste from our life and my life. From electricity to consumer items to food, I am viewing these aspects through a critical lens and shaping future practices. In part, this reflection has been part of my spiritual growth, a reflection on how I can be nourished through human connection, creativity, contribution, and nature, as opposed to consumerism and competition. It has been a transformative process. I've discovered through my community and climate activism a new network of friends, both in my neighborhood but also in Dundas and Hamilton. I found Action 13, a dynamic group of climate activists who are organizing sewing workshops, like sewing plants. And they also do sewing as well. It's like sewing and sewing. Anyway, and a pretty fabulous repair cafe. And I am collaboratively organizing a group of climate activists within the union movement. In Doppelganger, Naomi Klein writes, "It's tough to live in a moment when so many truths that have been sold as settled suddenly become wobbly and wavy under our fate. It's all tilting and rolling, and so much, like the assumed predictability of seasons, will never be stable again, at least not for several generations, and that is in the best case scenario. All of this destabilization places demands on us to change, to reassess, and to reimagine who we need to become. I don't know what the future holds and how things precisely are going to play out. I do know the world will look different. I also know that what we do today, the decisions we make about how we walk on the earth, is important. We have a responsibility to ourselves, to our children and grandchildren, and to any young person that we know, to reduce our emissions. However, I suggest that of equal, if not greater, importance is that we should be talking about the issue of climate change and building a world of climate activists, young and old. If anyone is interested in resources that Steve and I have discovered along the way, I do have, we have a website that shares that information, and it's printed on little business cards that are available in the foyer. Leads you to a website called Net Zero Dundas. And the mission of that is creating community to combat climate change. We continue to add to the site, and it also links to the Live Net Zero contest. To conclude, I share another quote from Bell Hooks: community is the power to create change. Thank you.
This is one of Jennifer's great adaptations to Jingle Bells. So this is when you can bring your shakers and jingle bells and all of that and sing along just to this.
I think we need to stand up again. No? All right, I'll give you an intro and that'll lift your spirits and your feet. Ready? Everybody up, here we go.
It's a joyous time for folks to have some fun. We spend a pretty dime on gifts for everyone. Think instead of these ideas that we share. They'll do more to please and make the world more fair.
Oh,
change, climate change, time to change our ways. Oh, what fun it is to try to slash the smoky haze.
Hey!
Climate change, time to change our ways. Oh, what fun it is to try to slash the smoky haze. Make a present now, it's something that's a blast. Regifting sure will do, use paper from the past. Or secondhand, together is key. Buy local, walk the land. Hell shit, can't you see? Change, time to change our ways. Oh, what fun it is to try to slash the smoky haze.
Hey!
Climate change, time to change our ways. Oh, what fun it is to try to slash the smoky haze.
Now hang on to your shakers, because there's another song coming. But first, our closing words. May we be gentle with ourselves. May we be loving with each other. May kindness find us and make peace a home in our hearts. May light shine in the dark nights of our soul. May warmth hold us against the cold. And may the chalice light that we extinguish go on shining in us after we leave this place, and may hope remain to lead us on. Over to you.
So you're gonna have to really shake that. I don't have a shaker with me, so I can't give you the, but it's quite a pop, a boppy, what's that? Oh, it's okay, no, okay. But you got to keep me on beat, because I'll slow down. So. All right. It goes to Traveling Wilburys, end of the line, but you sing it's now so the time instead of at the end of the line. And yeah, well, you'll get it as it. Oh, here we go again. Well, it's all right, riding around in the breeze. Well, it's all live the life you please. Well, it's all right, doing the best you can. Well, it's all right, as long as you lend a hand. Put on your shoes and travel the streets by walking. It's now so the time. Flow through the roads as you are biking. It's now so the time. Get from A to B on a bus or train. It's now so the time, the car is charging. Well, it's all right, we know that this ain't wrong. Well, it's all right, sometimes you gotta be strong. Well, it's all right, as long as you got somewhere to lay. Well, it's all right. Every day is net zero day. Maybe someday you'll take the road a ways. It's now's the time. Scooter through the streets like you are ablaze. It's now's the time. We can even be working from home some of these days. It's now's the time. All these ways. Well, it's all right, even when push comes to shove. Well, it's all right, if you've got someone to love. Well, it's all right, everything will work out fine. Well, it's all right, we know now that now is the time. I still depend upon the car I drive some of the time. I'm just glad the carpool rides can help us all thrive. Now's the time. Together we can do this side by side. It's now so the time. I'm satisfied.
Well, it's all right. Change is starting today. Well, it's all right. We've all got something to say. Well, it's all right. Remember that we all have to live. Well, it's all right. The best you can do is to give. Well, it's all right. Riding around on the breeze. Well, it's all right. We'll create the change, yes, please. Well, it's all right. We're gonna use a sun that shines. Well, it's all right. We're gonna save the world. It's time.
Now, so the time.
Thank you, everyone, and have a good day.